this year. 15 years usually is cost effective. It means if the project return its investment within less than 15 years, this is good. After 15 years, this means that it is not good enough, not cost effective. Okay. Now, the energy conservation measure, as I mentioned, we have six categories. Let me give example about this category. Category one is the architectural energy conservation measures. We're talking about here something input to the architectural and the buildings, let me say, or houses, which reflect on the energy consumption. Example, we use window sun shading to reduce the entrance of energy to the room, so we don't need more cooling, or double glazing, or these type of, let me say, advices. You can hear it is listed just a few, otherwise there are many. Another category is heat and heating and cooling. We can, let me say, make an insulator to reduce the, or use installed boiler control, or replace the inefficient heating plant, or convert electric ignition, and many other, let me say, applications could be used here to reduce the energy consumption. Domestic hot water system, okay? Use, install domestic hot water off-peak control, or insulate hot water tank itself to contaminate the heat, and so on. Lighting, as example, we replace the old fluorescent lamp with, as example, LED, okay? We install light control in a common area. We use sensors, as example, just in case if there is nobody in the area, the switches are off. When somebody moves, then it starts lighting. Miscellaneous, additional ECM. In each one of these categories, you can see we have different advices and different action to be taken. Now, next is the life cycle cost. Life cycle cost is the cost and cash flow, how it will work within my project, any project I produce or I invest in. And at the end, I need to look to the cost of energy. So we will look to the capital cost, the amount paid at the beginning, replacement cost, because every few years you need to replace some part of the system, maintenance cost, which is to be done yearly, salvage value. When the project finish 24 years, 30 years, you will sell part of it as a rubbish, okay? Or some, as example, in PV system, they sell the PV panels and the frame. Let's take this example. I will read from the example first. Faculty of Engineering Sound University students propose to install PV system to supply lighting for faculty building to generate 15 kilowatt hour of energy per day. The system designed to have the following components. They gave here information about solar module, charger controller, batteries, inverters, some information talking about the wattages, as example, how many panels I use, and so on. Okay. Also, he mentioned that the cost of the PV panels, the 16 panels used, is this amount, no money real. Cost of 12 batteries, this amount. Cost of charger controller, inverter, cable, frame, and cost of installation and commissioning, and cost of maintenance. Okay, still they give this information in the question, and also the capital cost, which represent all these costs, excluding the annual maintenance cost, it's not accounted here. It's found to be 8,567.4 Omani riyal. Now, also, he told you in the question that the PV will work for up to 24 years, batteries 6 years. So every 6 years, we need to change battery, charger controller, inverter cable, work for 12 years. So every 12 years, we need to change them. And also, he told you that the interest rate in Oman is 7% and the inflation rate in Oman is 4%. Furthermore, he told you in the question that 5 hours is the sun peak hours in Oman. And he asked you to find the life cycle cost and the cost of energy. Have a look how we work on this example. First of all, each panel produces 205 watt. So if I multiply it by the 5 hours a day, which is the peak sun hours, it gives me energy 1025 watt hour a day. Now, if I multiply this amount by 16 panels I have, then this is how much I produce daily, 16.4 kilowatt hour. Now, but before I go start with the calculation of the flow, let me show you the flow cash flow diagram here. Here at year number zero, this is the capital cost, okay? And every year, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I pay for annual maintenance cost. You can see here, every year I pay for annual maintenance cost until I reach 24 years. For battery, every 6 years I need to change battery. After 12 years, again battery, but also here, because 12 years from here to here, I change cable, charger controller, inverter, and battery, another 6 years I need to change, and so on. At the end, all these are minus. Here a plus, this is return, okay? It's return, okay? Here we are paying, here we are taking. Salvage, salvage means we will sell part of the project at the end. Now, how we work on cost life cycle cost? Have a look. We will calculate the present worth for each equipment. First of all, the main present worth is the capital cost. It's already calculated, right? But we need to add to this present worth because of every 6 years we need to change battery. There is formula which say that the present worth for is a battery cost times 1 plus F over 1 plus F rises to power, which is the number of years. So after 6 years, I will pay this for present worth. Another 6 years, so it means 12 years. Another 6 years, 18 years. I don't need another 6 years because I reached 24, which is the end of the project. Now, for the other present worth, you know that the charger, controller, cable, inverter, all of them to be changed in 12 years. So if I add their cost together, I will call them C. Then C multiplied by 1 plus F over 1 plus I rises to power 12, which means after 12 years, I need to change. For maintenance, present worth for maintenance cost, now, we have different formula used for this. You don't need to know from where it came, this formula, but just use them because it's a procedure we need to follow in calculating the cost of energy and life cycle cost. Now, for present worth, the annual maintenance cost, which is given in the table, times this formula, we have everything for 24 years. We calculate it. For salvage, we will salvage, the main cost of salvage is the PV cost and the frame only. So if I add them and multiply by this expression, I got how much the salvage. Now, the life cycle cost will be, have a look, present worth, I all these calculated minus the salvage, okay? So this is the total amount. Now, annual life cycle cost will equal to, use this formula usually to calculate the annual because I needed to calculate cost of energy. Have a look, life cycle cost, which is we already calculated here, divided by this expression, which give me ALCC. Now, cost of energy can be calculated by dividing annual life cycle cost over 365 days times the total energy collected daily. Then it will give me the cost of kilowatt hour in Omani Riyal. Now, there is another one, which is not LCC, now LCA, life cycle analysis. Life cycle analysis is the impact of our project from A to Z on the environment. But mean from when getting the raw material from the nature, then manufacture it, produce equipment, then use it, then recycle it, and back to it. So all these cycles, as you can see here, you start from nature, rotate back to nature, okay? In life cycle costs, we have a plan we need to follow. By the way, now, regardless your specialty, you are at the end to be graduate as an engineer, you will deal with systems, electrical, mechanical, chemical, civil. You know the technical issues related to your specialty, but this is not enough. You need to look to the environment. We need to look to the cost. For cost, we just discussed life cycle cost. For environment, we are talking about life cycle analysis. We need to put to go according to the plan, put goals and scope, and then inventory analysis to see the outputs, inputs and outputs, and how they impact with their impact on environment. impact analysis. After you get the impact, analyze it, and then interpretation. So it's a cycle to see the impact of your system on the environment. Now, last type of energy to be discussed is geothermal energy. Geothermal energy is energy under the ground. You know, under the ground, when you go deeply down in the under the ground, you will find that the heat is increased. This heat could appear as a hot rocks, sorry, as a hot water, as a steam, a hot air coming from down. Okay, and this is stay there as a hot spring. Let me say, as you can see in these photos, for millions of years, whatever we consume still there, and it's for that it's renewable energy source. As you can see here, this is the surface of the earth, and we go deep down. This is in kilometer. You can see the temperature increase. If we can know how to extract this temperature and use it, that will be a wonderful source of energy. What happened is these geothermal resources available in many locations on the planet, in many countries. In some countries they are more, in some countries they are less, but wherever we find them, let's go and use them. In Oman there is some places, in Rustaq, in Nakhal, there are some hot water there. We can use it, and in many other places. Now, this is the geothermal reservoir, as you can see here. This is the heat under the ground, and water, when it's rain, it's go down, leaked, and then it gets heated, and it can go up as a hot water, or as a steam, or as a air. As air. Now, geothermal electricity. Geothermal used to generate electricity. It's similar to any other thermal system. Just here, we don't burn fuel. The heat coming from the underground, as you can see here, under the ground, through the heat exchanger, it's transfer the heat to the fluid, which is vaporized, rotate turbo generator, generate electricity. So it's very similar to the thermal system. In many countries, as example, in United States, this is all data 2003, you can see their profile is rich with many sources of energy, coal, natural gas, petroleum, nuclear, and so on, and renewable energies take a share. Geothermal is only 5% of this 6% of renewable energy. It doesn't matter. Don't look that it is just simple part. Look that this is nature, and you're taking it from nature using your resources, your own resources, even if it is a small fraction of the whole profile. Now, for geothermal also use for heating and cooling. You know, under the ground in summer, it's cold, so the animals came, rabbits and rats, and go under the ground because it's cold. And in winter, the opposite, it's warm, so they go down. So we can use heat for heating and cooling. And simply, we make pipes like this. You see these pipes here, network under the ground, okay? So the red here is hot, the cold, the blue here is cold. And if we want to cool, we rotate in this direction. If we want to heat, we rotate in this direction, right? Pump, rotate the water, which bring the hot or the cold. And then, sorry, is get heating. This is also, as you can see here, direct heating. They pump the air here, and then it go to a heat exchanger, and then from heat exchanger, it go to energy either to for cooling, heating, see what you want to do, and then pump to rotate the water. Geothermal heat pump using this. This is what we've been talking about is we use a heat pump to pump the water from the under the ground in different way, vertical, horizontal, hybrid, from well to well. Let me explain it on figure. Have a look here. This house, we want to heat it. We look to the hot, to the heat coming source. Is it close? Is it vertical? Is it horizontal? As example, if it is down here, we use vertical to bring water flowing here and then get heated, and then inside the heat, sorry, saved inside, and then it can be used for heating or for ventilation. If it is close, I mean to the surface, so then use vertical, horizontal. If there is wells, two wells, hot well and cold well, we can't take water from here to for heating. Or if it's cooling, we do the opposite. And if it is a pond, as example, we took water pumped from one side of the, let me say, on the near the surface when it's warm, to get heated inside and return back down in the cold part. Now, geothermal power plants which generate electricity, we have different type of power plants. We have a flash power, dry binary, flash binary. Flash power plant, what's happening is in a flash, what they do, we brought the hot water from the geothermal reservoir and we split it into hot water returning back and the steam. We need the steam because steam will rotate the turbo generator and generate electricity. The other one is a dry steam power plant. As you can see here, this is a power plant available in one country. We use the steam directly. There is no hot water, direct steam coming and rotate turbo generator. Another plant you see here, this is, as you can see, steam coming from under the ground, directly use it. Binary power plants. Binary power plants, time the binary, let me say, the geothermal reservoir temperature is lower than 100. Okay, you know that water converts into steam in 100 Celsius. But when if it is lower than this, we can use binary power plant where we use heat exchanger and another liquid which can vaporize with less temperature. As you can see here, the warm water coming here, the hot water, give it to the heat exchanger. There is a fluid here which is vaporized in small temperature and then rotate turbo generator and return back. Another one is a flash binary. Both of them, we can use the water directly here, okay, to produce steam, rotate the turbo generator and return back here to the another heat exchanger here, or let me say another boiler here, which help here to produce another steam and so on. Enhanced geothermal system. We have rocks under the ground, but we don't have water. We can use water, with ammonia mixed to get the heat. Or let me say, we can pump the water down to the rocks to get the heat. Sometimes there is no water, so we bring the water and try to get heated. Mixed water, working fluid in the heat exchanger, the fluid we can could be give better performance. If it is mixed, as example, in this system, which is invented by Kalina system, it is called Kalina system in 2009, it's used a mix of ammonia and water together. Distribution generation. In electrical engineering, we know that distribution generator is generators side to the network, to the utility in different places, which help and support. Now, the geothermal reservoirs is different locations. We can use them to generate electricity and also feed the grid in different locations. It's behave like a distributed generator. Supercritical cycles. Supercritical cycles, what we do, we use carbon dioxide. We pump it, you know, we will talk about it in next week, inshallah, in week number 13. We will see that carbon to be captured and storage under the ground. So we can't use it, pump it into down the to the under the ground to the hot rock and to bring, let me say, the heat from these rocks. I will stop here and looking to have another discussion next week with climate change and the effect of energy on climate.